Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful, peace be upon Prophet. I would like to welcome everybody. This is the third session of the today program. Actually, we are supposed to have four speakers in the session, but so far Christopher Copper Davis and Nur Efolu have appeared. Inshallah, we hope during the meantime, the Borja and Aliz Ahmed also will appear on the screen. We are planning to give 15 minutes for each speakers. Let's start with this way. Maybe they will join on the program. That's why I don't want to cut off their time. So please, Christopher Davis, let me say something about you, first of all. Christopher Davis is a PhD candidate in Cambridge University Faculty of History. Inshallah, he will finish his PhD dissertation very soon. He will give a speech on this topic, between sect, region, and nation in Mandatory Iraq, the not-so-sectarian political identity and political path of al-Sharqi and Hizbun Nahda. Please go ahead, Mr. Davis. You have 15 minutes.
All right, brilliant. I think I can be heard, I assume. But anyway, thank you very much for having me and for organizing this. Basically, I wanted to give this presentation just to kind of present an aspect of my PhD research, which I'm working on at the moment and hoping to eventually pull up into an article. And it's essentially an attempt to, I guess, reappraise some kind of dominant conceptions about Iraqi politics in the 1920s. And specifically, I guess, I want to do this by analysing the importance of regional identity and specifically a conception of identity tied to the people and place and the lands around the Euphrates River. So in southern Iraq, mainly, but also, well, the whole of the Euphrates going down to Basra. And the importance of this, this locality for the formation of modern political subjectivities in Iraq. And basically, I want to use this to kind of challenge a lot of the, the preponderance in the existing historiography, which is still focusing too much on sectarian conflicts and theories of sectarianism between Sunnis and Shias. Basically, my argument is that peripheral actors from the Euphrates region, especially from the mid-Euphrates and around places like Najaf, grappled with the opportunities and challenges thrown open by, you know, national integration and the fall of the Ottoman Empire, and created original and sophisticated political thought, which was regional focused, but also civic and nationalist. And I think this is a really good case study, the one that I look at in this paper, for basically illustrating how a lot of our kind of analytical language around sectarianism is quite weak and in need of review. And basically the paper does this by looking specifically at Ali al-Sharqi and a political party that he was the primary ideologue for, the Hizb al-Nahda. So if I go to the next slide, So first, some background, I guess, is necessary on the Hizb al-Nahda. So the Hizb al-Nahda was actually one of the first political parties ever founded in Iraq by some Shia merchants from Baghdad in 1922. It was set up to resist the British mandate and worked with other opposition parties in Iraq and also with the Shia religious authorities in Karbala and Najaf to sort of launch the anti-mandate campaign in the early years of the state. Because it was quite successful in this, it was immediately suppressed by the British and the pro-British government, and its leaders were actually exiled to the island of Henjem. It then resurfaced again in 1925 and became a kind of dominant force in Iraqi politics until the end of the 1920s. Now, broadly, its kind of political positions and the political issues that it campaigned on were similar to the other opposition parties in Iraq. It was kind of nationalist, democratic, quite broadly based, but it did have a particular contingent. And this contingent, I'm going to argue, was essentially tied to the Euphrates. And because of this, it forwarded particular policy positions to appeal to that contingent. And one of them was a staunch opposition to conscription, which the Iraqi government tried to introduce in the mid-1920s. And the other was Shia issues. So it called for a more representative Iraqi government, a more representative parliament, and it also called for Shia judges to be used in areas of the country that was majority Shia. And its main kind of axis of operation was basically around Baghdad, Basra, and then the cities of the Euphrates, stretching, yeah, so we're including like Karbala and Najaf here specifically. So the dominant kind of historiography on the party has basically concluded that this party was a sectarian party and was pretty much the first manifestation of sectarianism or Shia sectarianism in Iraq. It kind of like follows a master narrative that the Iraqi state was dominated by a small cabal of corrupt Sunni elites, ex-Ottoman officers, etc., who excluded most of the Shia population. So a group of Shias formed their own party, described as professedly sectarian or, you know, just a Shia party, to campaign to get government positions and resources for themselves, or to secede from the state altogether. Some historians have even said that. And there is some, I'm not trying to deny the fact that this party has something to do with Shia identity or that Shia identity was important. It was actually formed, the party actually got some of its momentum in the wake of several sort of sectarian scandals in Iraq, some of them more famous than others. One of them concerned the publication of a book glorifying the Umayyad Caliphate, which was going to be used in the Iraqi curriculum. Another was a violent incident during a Shia mourning ceremony in Qadamiyah. And at the same time, as I've already said, there was this certain policy positions of the party did pertain to distinctly confessional concerns. But I think what we have to appreciate as well is that these interpretations of the party that have actually predominated and that I think are much more reflective of a dominant kind of framework for understanding Iraqi politics in this period mirror a lot of many of the interpretations that the British colonial authorities applied to the party. You know, they monitored the Hezbollah Nahda incredibly closely during the 1920s. They sent intelligence officers out to follow it, tracked its meetings, and their perceptions, which were obviously determined by the interests of their power and the interests of their position of authority in Iraq, were to frame the party as an anti-Sunni movement and basically a sort of a primordial aberration blocking national development as they saw it should work along, you know, European lines. So I think that these interpretations of the party are quite evidently an attempt to delegitimize so that their client state would essentially remain in power. And this is quite obvious. And it's obviously an unfortunate reality that then that these interpretations have filtered through into the secondary literature and actually, well, they dominate the secondary literature. Most of it is based upon the interpretations of the colonial archive without taking into account the political subjectivities and the political ideas of the party itself. And that's what I actually want to talk about now, I guess, for the rest of the presentation. So the main ideologue of the party, the man who did the most work for it, the man who wrote the most in its name was Ali al-Sharqi. Had a bit of background on him. He was born in Najaf in 1892 to a kind of scholarly family. His dad died when he was quite young, so he was raised in the family home, actually, of the very famous Najafi poet Muhammad Mahdi al-Jawahiri. He's basically a kind of quintessential man of the early Najafi Nahda before the First World War, publishing poetry in Lebanon, in Iraq, and Baghdad. Writing quite kind of like robust criticisms of the conservatism of the Shia religious establishment, and also becoming like an early advocate of Arabism in southern Iraq. So he was very critical of the Ottoman Empire, especially in the years from sort of 1910 onwards, when the CUP began to implement more kind of authoritarian tendencies in Iraq. And this is reflected in the way that he negotiated the First World War when it finally came to Iraq in 1914. At first, he sort of threw his lot in with the Ottomans, but he was quite quick to change sides and think, actually, I'm going to try and further the Arab cause here. And his Arabism seems to have been influenced by kind of two broad strands. One of them is the rich kind of poetic tradition of Najaf, the literary tradition there. And the other is this sort of fascination he developed with rural Arab life that he developed living around in the rural areas of the Euphrates, specifically the lower Euphrates, just before the First World War. So he went there to avoid Ottoman conscription. He lived in Al-Shatra, which is a town on the river of Gharaf, which is near the Euphrates. And he there he befriended many of the local notables, including the man who would become the future prime minister of Iraq, Abdul Muhsin al-Sa'dun, who actually committed suicide in 1928. But prior to this, he was a real admirer of this political figure, which I think is very significant for his kind of like political maturation. Anyway, after the First World War, he becomes an ardent Iraqi Arab nationalist, spends all of his time writing, and eventually becomes the main activist for the Hizb al-Nahda in 1927, moving to Baghdad and writing reams and reams of material in the party's newspaper, al-Nahda al-Iraqiyya, which essentially set out a kind of political and historical narrative of what the party was and what it meant. And what was that? I see these articles essentially as a manifesto for the party. And they tell a very different story to the story that you find in the colonial archive and the one that seems to have filtered through into the kind of conventional understandings of the party and the historiography, and that reflects this broader sectarian narrative. I think it's much more complicated than that. It seems like his ideas were very influenced by his kind of his youth growing up in Najaf before the war. There's lots of influences of the constitutional ideas stemming from the Iranian and Ottoman constitutional revolutions. So he's basically got this sort of civic notion of nationalism, in which he thinks that the kind of moral and political progress of the nation can only be achieved for encouraging associational activity, and basically for a kind of robust and dynamic public sphere. And he thinks that this will transform the atomized and individualistic individual of the past into the kind of socially minded national subject. And he, to give this this kind of broader political framework, kind of a basis, he looks to the a particular region of Iraq, and this is the Euphrates, where he was born, obviously in Najaf, and where he spent pretty much all of his life, and where he has this kind of shared sense along the other people from that region that they're losing out in the new Iraqi state. You know, they're not getting the kind of equality that they would expect. And for him, the Euphrates is it's almost like a lexical device for imagining a conception of nationhood that is both Iraqist and Arabist. And he writes this like sort of ancient history of Iraq, which basically says that the Euphrates and Hejaz were the birthplace of the Arab nation, and that there was this continuity of Arab life and existence in this area, predating even the Islamic conquests, and that really the people of the Euphrates are kind of the most authentic Arab populations in the whole of Iraq. And this narrative is so secular that he actually sort of sees, you know, he takes his back before Islam, and he almost sees the fact that Shiism has spread in these areas, and the fact that Shiism is so popular in these areas, it's kind of just like a temporary and not even necessarily that important for the identity of the region. It's much more to do with this kind of much deeper and long-lasting Arab influence. And then in the modern period, it's very much that the people of the Euphrates, I mean, according to his historical narrative, have sacrificed most and suffered most for the name of the Iraqi nation. And this is actually repeating quite a common trope in lots of Iraqi historical writing, that it was the tribes from the Euphrates that suffered most during the revolution of 1920, but then sort of got the fewest spoils of the pie, of the fruits of national progress. So I'm not going to go into too much. I mean, I'm not going to go into too much detail about what he actually writes. But this notion of al-Furatiyun is constantly coming back in his manifesto, and really. That is what he means. That is what his conception of what like the sort of the Iraqi political subject is. It's got very little to do with confessional concerns. So just finally, before I finish, why is this important? I guess you could say it's completely unimportant, but basically, I want to try and argue that the programmatic considerations of this party, the Hizb al-Nahda, reflected this regional Euphrates concerns. And this is both the kind of experiential affair and also a kind of cultural issue, as well as civic nationalist ideas about association, constitutionalism, and democracy. So this kind of follows from a general reappraisal of Iraqi politics in the 1920s that's been going on for the last decade and a half or so, which I think is trying to get beyond these sort of reductive assertions about, I guess, the 1920s being a kind of pre-ideological age. The second point that I think is very important to raise, that I want to raise anyway, is that the labeling of this party as sectarian, as has been done by all of the historiography to date, seems pretty much to just reproduce the delegitimizing strategies of state elites and the colonial state. And these actually worked, I guess, at the time, because the party didn't survive. It was essentially effectively delegitimized. And I think that the fact that this is the case kind of reveals a general shortcoming in a lot of our analytical language around sectarianism. It seems to be, at the moment, almost like a catch-all notion to explain political behavior and political phenomena in the Middle East, and ultimately obscures a lot more than it explains, and it reproduces a kind of compendium of tropes and ideas that essentially belong, I think, in the colonial archive or into elite nationalist discourses, and are intended specifically to obscure political nuance, the inevitable political nuance that exists within these political movements. And the Hizb al-Nahda, I mean, I think is a very good case study for showing this. And I'll leave it there, but thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much for your presentation. If you don't mind, I would like to give a brief summary what you talk about in Turkish, maybe for the listeners, if you don't mind.
Of course.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thank you so much. Mr. Davison, doktora tez konu. Ha, by the way, other speakers, please, could you turn on your camera? I can see you. Okay. Okay, welcome. Borja Gonzalez, right? Welcome. You are on the line right now? Okay, we can see you.
For the time being.
Okay, thank you so much. By the way, okay, sorry. Mr. Christopher Davison, ana noktası şu arkadaşlar. Özellikle Irak'taki yapılanmada bu Hizb al-Nahda'nın konumu ve onun da baş aktörü olan, ki aktivist olarak tanımlıyor kendisileri, bu efendim Ali Şarkey'in fikirleri üzerinde yoğunlaşan bir sunum oldu. Özellikle bu işte Irak'ta devlet yapılanmasında Şiilerin konumu ne olacak, işte parlamentoda çok fazla temsil talepleri, bu konuda Şarkey'in farklı yaklaşımları var. Özellikle gazete yayınladığı bir takım makalelerle o biraz daha meseleye bu Arap kökeninin devamı tarafında, taraftarında ve bir de bu bölge için bu Fırat ehli tabirini, Fıratiyun tabirini kullanıyor. Dolayısıyla böyle ortada bir yer alıyor tabiri caizse. Burada sunum yapan Mr. Davis temas etmedi. Fakat burada özetinde iki tane daha şahıstan bahsediyor. Doktor Sara Pasley, bir de Doktor Orit Bakşin. Bunların fikirlerini desteklediğini söylüyor. Yani bu bir mezhebi bakış açısı mıdır, yoksa Irak'ın yapılanmasında efendim bu Arap kökünü devam ettirerek, o lineage, yani o hattı devam ettirerek, özellikle bu Fıratiyun ehli, ki bu mesela şiirlerin burayı doldurduğuna dair bir takım tespitleri de oldu, ama o daha çok bu Fıratiyun kavramını tercih ediyor. That's right, Mr. Davis. El-Şarki choose to use the term of Fıratiyun.
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay, we can move to second speaker. Okay, Nur Efeoğlu from Brussels. She's going to give a speech, the representation of the Seljuk and Ottoman passed in the British Museums a comparative critical analysis of the displays and labels. Okay, you have 15 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I just uploaded my presentation, but I can't see it now. Could you please help me about with this?
Safa, could you help her, please?
Should I apply again?
Safa, do you hear me? Safa Hoca. Try, please, again, maybe. You cannot
okay, let me try again.
Okay, please.
Can you upload your presentation, please?
Yeah, I'm just waiting. I can't see it now. That's 2 minutes.
Okay, wait, maybe.
Sorry about that.
No problem. It happens sometimes. It's quite
thinking
normal.
That one is enough, that's why.
This is uploading?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe it takes time.
It's done.
Okay, that's good. Great.
Can you see now?
Sure, yes, we can see. Yeah. We can see also.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're nice.
And hello again, everyone. Today I would like to talk about the permanent displays of Seljuk and Ottoman materials in three national museums in the United Kingdom: the British Museum, the Victoria and Albert Museum, and the National Museum of Scotland. These three museums were chosen because they are among the most visited museums in the world, as well as having large collections of Islamic art. A detailed study on Seljuk and Ottoman artifacts in these museums would constitute an important contribution to research on Islamic art and museum studies, and allow a comparison to be made in how this material is displayed and interpreted in a Western country. To better understand what is meant by Seljuk and Ottoman, we can have a look at these two maps. These maps illustrate the widest boundaries of the Seljuk and Ottoman dynasties. Both empires dominated extensive and multi-ethnic lands for considerable periods of time. Seljuk and Ottoman dynasties encompassed two different geographical polities, one within Anatolia, the other encompassing large areas of the Mediterranean, Red Sea, and Arabian Gulf, namely a huge multi-ethnic empire stretching from Europe to Egypt and Arabia. The analysis of museum displays is an attempt to read and analyze what is these stories tell visitors in terms of the representation of different cultures. To achieve the objective of analyzing museum displays, Seljuk and Ottoman artifacts exhibited in three museums were evaluated in terms of their number, location in the museum, material types, geographical and temporal origins. If I may, I would like to start with British Museum. In the British Museum, 156 Ottoman and 41 Seljuk objects are on display at the time of the research. These artifacts were determined by comparing the field study carried out in June 2019 and the online collection on the British Museum website. When looking at the material types of the Seljuk materials in the British Museum, there are mostly ceramics and metalworks on display. Just like the Seljuk objects, most of the Ottoman period artifacts on display are ceramics and metalworks as well. As will be seen in the collections of the other two museums, the Ottoman period ceramics are always in the majority compared to the other materials types among the displayed objects. The reason for this is that since 15th century, Islamic ceramics gained popularity and a great reputation, not only in the Ottoman geography, but also in Europe with their beauty and their good quality. These tables present the galleries where the Seljuk and Ottoman objects are exhibited in the British Museum. According to the data given in the table, 36 Seljuk and 122 Ottoman objects are in the Middle East Gallery. Since most of the artifacts are exhibited there, the Middle East Gallery and the Ottoman and Seljuk exhibitions here have been discussed in detail, and the representation of these two cultures in the museum have been evaluated through this gallery. This gallery map illustrates the location of the Middle East galleries in the British Museum. The Middle East galleries comprises two rooms, room 42 and 43, presenting the cultures of Islamic world from about 100 to the present day, and comprised West Africa to Southeast Asia. It is noteworthy that the Middle East galleries are quite large compared to the other galleries on the same floor. In addition, its proximity to the galleries of the museum's most popular collections is a factor that enhanced the visitor potential of the Islamic World Gallery. According to the lead curator of the British Museum Middle East Gallery, Dr. Venetia Porter, this is about giving the Middle East Gallery that symbolic importance. This is the overall view of the Islamic World Gallery of the British Museum. In Gallery 42, Seljuk objects mostly located in cases named Syria and Iraq and Iran and Central Asia. Although there are specific sections for the Fatimid, Mongol, Mamluk and Ilkhanid periods in the gallery, it is surprising that there is no satisfying information about the Seljuk dynasty. In the labels of Seljuk materials, they are shown as objects belong to Iran, Iraq and Syria. Materials from the Ottoman period are mostly displayed in room 43 on the right hand side. Unlike Seljuk objects, there are six different cases in the gallery related to Ottoman culture. It is also seen that some Ottoman materials are exhibited in the other cases as well. As a general evaluation of the Islamic World Gallery in the British Museum, it is visually quite engaging to visitors, and it's also informative in terms of the exhibition style. However, because of the word limitation, objects labels can contain only limited information. Therefore, as mentioned before, about Seljuk objects, some materials need more information about their background, their cultural identity, or explanation about the inscription on them. Since the gallery has its own website with detailed description about each object, QR codes could be a way to direct visitors to these descriptions that already exist in museum websites but are not widely used. In terms of representation of the Seljuk and Ottoman cultures in the gallery, Seljuk objects are displayed poorly when compared to the Ottoman materials. This is due to the large number of Ottoman objects in the collection and the popularity of these objects, but the lack of satisfactory information about the Seljuk dynasty leads to the conclusion that this culture is not adequately represented in the museum. Now I would like to move to the Victoria and Albert Museum. In the Victoria and Albert Museum, 328 Ottoman and 77 Seljuk objects were on display at the time of the research. These tables illustrate the material types of the artifacts sourced to the Seljuk and Ottoman dynasties and their approximate numbers. When looking at the tables, it is striking that almost all the Seljuk artifacts on display are ceramics. Although the product variety is more than the Seljuk materials, a similar situation regarding ceramics is also valid for Ottoman artifacts on display. The table on the left illustrates the approximate number of materials belong to the Seljuk Empire on display and their location in the V&A Museum. As seen in the table, most of the objects are in the ceramic rooms, 72 objects in total. Considering that the Seljuk Empire was a Muslim state that ruled over the Middle East regions such as Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Anatolia for a long period of time, it is quite surprising that only three artifacts belonging to this dynasty are exhibited in the Islamic Middle East Gallery. When looking at the materials belonging to the Ottoman Empire, it is seen that the situation is opposite. As mentioned before, there are 328 objects sourced to the Ottoman Empire on display in the V&A Museum galleries. Compared to the other museums, this is quite a high figure. Since most of the Seljuk and Ottoman artifacts are exhibited in these two galleries, I would like to mention the Islamic Middle East Gallery and the ceramic rooms briefly. In the ceramic rooms, a total 217 objects evaluated within the scope of this study are examined, 72 of which belong to Seljuk period and 145 to the Ottoman period. As a general overview of ceramic galleries in the V&A Museum, the absence of the labels accompanying the objects, the fact that the works are placed in such a tight manner that they close each other and make it difficult to see, make the exhibition somewhat complex and become difficult to distinguish. On the other hand, considering the exhibition style applied in the gallery, it doesn't seem possible to include the label of each object. The gallery where Seljuk and Ottoman artifacts are exhibited with the second majority is the Islamic Middle East Gallery. The Islamic Middle East Gallery is full of aesthetic pieces that impress at first look. The curators of the gallery stated that in accordance with the policy of the V&A Museum, often aesthetic judgment comes first rather than cultural importance. This idea behind the selection of objects is the difference between the British Museum and Victoria and Albert Museum. As seen on the map, the Islamic Middle East Gallery is located in a very central area of the museum. The gallery is adjacent to the main shop of the museum. This in turn increased the visitor potential of the gallery by attracting the attention of even visitors who don't intend to visit this collection. Moreover, this central location of the gallery underlines the importance given the artifacts exhibited here by the museum. In terms of displaying and representation of Seljuk and Ottoman materials in the gallery, as in the British Museum, no information about the Seljuk Empire could be found in the V&A Museum Islamic Middle East Gallery. On the other hand, there are 8 thematic cases about the Ottoman Empire. It is seen that Ottoman materials are quite dominant throughout the gallery. As a general overview, a visitor who visits the Islamic Middle East Gallery of the Victoria and Albert Museum may not even be aware of the existence of the Seljuk dynasty, but they will leave the museum with a piece of extensive knowledge about the Ottoman Empire in many different fields. Finally, I would like to mention the displays in the National Museum of Scotland. In the National Museum of Scotland, 6 Seljuk and 11 Ottoman artifacts were on display at the time of the research. To begin with, it should be noted that compared to the other two museums, very few materials are exhibited in this museum. This is because, unlike the other two museums, there is no specific gallery of the Middle East or Islamic art. The galleries of the National Museum of Scotland are arranged in a very different thematic manner and Islamic objects are to be found predominantly in world culture galleries. As can be seen in tables, as in the other two museums, ceramics are in the majority in this museum as well. These tables illustrate the locations and approximate number of Seljuk and Ottoman artifacts displayed in the National Museum of Scotland. As mentioned before, Seljuk and Ottoman objects are placed in these galleries in accordance with their themes. For example, tulip pattern Isnik ceramics are displayed in the Inspired by Nature Gallery. As in the other two museums, it is stated in the records of this museum that all the Seljuk objects belong to Iran. The cultural period or dynasty to which they belong is not specified. As a general evaluation, the National Museum Scotland has adopted a very different display style than the other national museums. This thematic style is making sense when the museum is visited by knowing the holistic exhibition style of the museum and the purpose of the exhibitions. Otherwise, it can be complex and incomprehensible for a random visit. In the National Museum Scotland, objects from all over the world are located in the same gallery without any geographical, cultural, or temporal distinction around a theme. Regarding the representation of two specific cultures in the National Museum of Scotland, the Seljuks and the Ottomans, it doesn't seem that both cultures are well represented to visitors. The reason behind this is that there are very limited artifacts being displayed in the museum, and also these objects are located in different areas, so it doesn't give an overall picture of the cultures to visitors. As a result, it is seen that the exhibition forms or display styles of museums vary depending on their objectives. Since the British Museum is a history museum, the display format is more informative and detailed. The Victoria and Albert Museum, on the other hand, makes a visual presentation with the best quality of works, as it is a museum of art and design. Looking at the National Museum of Scotland, it is seen that a thematic display style that deals with world cultures as a whole. Another point is museums are sourced for many fields such as history, cultural studies, heritage studies, and art history. In this respect, they are much more than only entertainment places. This study clearly showed that the information about the materials exhibited in museums is insufficient in some cases. It is important for museums to develop their technological aspects in order to facilitate access to information. Developing websites and adding QR codes to objects labels can be a few suggestions for this. Thank you very much for listening. If you have questions, I would be happy to answer them. Sorry if I passed the time limitation.
No, just on time. We thank you very much. It was a good presentation. With your permission, let me say something about, as a brief summary of your presentation. Nur Efeoğlu Hanım, in Turkish, with your permission. Doktor öğrencisi Exeter Üniversitesi'nde efendim ve orada Arap İslam Araştırmalar Enstitüsü'nde İslam Arkeoloji Merkezi'nde doktora yapıyor. Biraz konuşmuştuk, herhalde şu anda son safhasına gelmiş. Başarılar diliyoruz.
Çok teşekkür ederim.
Özellikle 3 müze üzerinden bir okuma yapmış Hoca Hanım. Ve oradaki Osmanlı ve Selçuklu eserlerinin sergilenmesi ve bu label kelimesini biraz açar mısınız? Label. Bu yani oradaki kısa bilgi veren etiketler midir onlar?
Label. Evet hocam. Her objenin altında bulunan bilgi etiketleri ve aynı zamanda her bölümün üzerinde bulunan bilgi panelleri.
Tamam. Onun üzerinden siz bir okuma yapıyorsunuz. Tabii çok haklısınız. Müzeler özellikle tarih ve kültür medeniyet için ana merkezler oluyor. Oradaki bir eser üzerinden birçok okumalar yapabiliyor. Bir para bile, sikke bile, oradaki bir yazı, orada bulunan bir eser tarihin ana kaynaklarına girişte çok önemli. Bu hakikaten tarihinde ana kaynaklarından birisidir ve bunlara da eğilmek de lazım. Ben tebrik ediyorum şahsen. Tabii siz 3 müziği seçtiğini söylediniz. Özellikle bunların da eser olarak yoğunluklu olan 3 müze olduğunu ifade ettiniz. Kendi içerisinde ki şöyle sunumda anlaşıldığı kadar Osmanlı eserleri daha yoğun gözüküyor Selçuklu'ya oranla. Şunu merak ederim, belki cevaplarsınız. Acaba bunlar unik müzeler mıdır? Bunların mesela son müzenin İran kaynaklı eserlerden oluştuğunu daha çok ifade ettiniz. Belki bunlar unik müzeler veya kopiler var mıdır? Bunu da belki sonunda şey yaparsınız, ifade edersiniz. Ve bu 3 müze üzerinden efendim Hoca Hanım bu bir tarih okuması yapıyor. Bunları yani Osmanlı'nın tarihini, sanatını, Selçuklu'nun tarih sanatını sunan, temsil eden eserler olduklarını ifade ediyor. Bu arada tabii müzelerin teknoloji kurumlarından da bahsettiğini, mesela son müze daha teknolojik, belki visual açısından daha görsel malzemeyle dolu ve yenilenmesi gerektiğini ifade ediyorsunuz. Yine bu arada bu siz araştırma süresinde müzelerin müdürleriyle beraber görüşme yaptığını ifade ettiniz. Efendim ve bundan da müteveccih belki bir takım müze gezilerinin de çok önemli olduğunu, hatta izninizle Fuat Sezgin Hoca'yı da anmak gerekiyor. Malum İstanbul'daki falan büyük müze de zaten değerli o bir eser diyor. Tarihin belki tümünü size veya büyük kesitini sunabilir. Onu da rahmetle anmış olalım. Evet. Sonuç olarak da şunu ifade ettiniz. Anladığımız kadarıyla özellikle bu 3 müzenin kıyaslandığı diğer müzeler in comparison with the other museum, they have the large potential displays and the art crafts for the Ottomans and Selçuklu, yani iki dönem içinde daha geniş eserlere haiz olduğunu ifade ediyorsunuz ve bunların dolaşılmasının da insanların tekrar ifade edelim tarihle buluşmasına büyük katkı sağladığını beyan ettiniz efendim. Çok teşekkür ederim. Thank you very much. Maybe at the end, if there is a question, you can also answer. Sure. Okay. Now, with your permission, we can move to other speakers. Borja Gonzalez Fernandez. Do you hear
Hello?
Me?
Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, but we cannot see you. There's a problem with your camera, sir.
It seems that my signal is too, my internet connection is too slow. So I will, if I connect my camera, it would be problematic, I think.
Okay, try, otherwise we can hear you on the microphone. No problem. Just.
Okay, let's try.
Please, kindly.
Shall I start?
Yes, we can see you. Good, mashallah. Welcome on screen. We have to see, you know. It's exciting. Anyhow, okay, let me say something about you with your permission, but it disappeared again. Anyhow.
Yes, I mean, now it's the connection that down. Let's hope that it gets better.
Your supply weak, that's why maybe. Anyhow, no problem. As far as I know, you're from Madrid Özerk University, that's right? Autonomous University.
I was at the Autonoma, but then I was hired by Necmettin Erbakan at the beginning of this academic year.
Okay. Okay. Right now you are with us.
Yes, I am.
In Konya?
Yes, I am at the Faculty of Political Science right now.
Oh, there is a problem. That's why at the top of the campus. Oh my God. Keşke you have to come to our faculty. We have a strong internet connection, you know.
Probably the issue is the computer.
Okay, welcome. Yes, the topic is, with your permission, let me say something.
Yes.
Patriarch Lublin, the Maronite Patriarch from parochialism to national, maybe pronouncing that good, role Patriarch Lublin, Maroni, evet. Yes, Maroni Patriği'nin konumunu değerlendirecek değerli katılımcılar, dinleyiciler. Please, go ahead.
Okay, so first of all, thank you for having me, and I would also like to extend my congratulations to my fellow presenters at this panel, whose presentations have been extremely interesting. Without further ado, I begin my presentation by going back into the past to September the 1st, 1920, when the French High Commissioner in the Levant, General Henri Gouraud, solemnly proclaimed the state of Greater Lebanon. Beside him, sitting atop the frontal staircase of the Résidence des Pins, which is the residence of the High Commissioner and at present the French Embassy in Lebanon, the Maronite Patriarch, Ilyas Al-Huayek, could feel legitimately satisfied at the fulfillment of his political goals. Slightly over a year before this scene, the Patriarch, as Lebanon's de facto head of state, had traveled to the Paris Peace Conference, where he pleaded Lebanon's case, underlining the differences between Lebanon, which in his own words was the main homeland of Western culture in the Orient, end quote, and Syria, which the Patriarch defined as a Bedouin country. Received by the paradoxically anti-clerical French premier, Georges Clemenceau, the Patriarch managed to get his support for the establishment of a separate and enlarged Lebanese state. The actions of Monseigneur Huayek resulted from a long historical process whereby the Maronite Church, a community of goatherds and peasants, in the words of Anne Longva, hidden behind the mountain fastness of the rugged homeland, would progressively acquire an identity as a Sha'ab, or people. Open to the West ever since the Crusades, this connection to the European world not only transformed the liturgy and doctrines of the hierarchical church, but also had a profound impact on popular self-perceptions, providing the community with an almost eschatological perception of reality, permanently awaiting for a deliverance coming from the West. Beyond the world of identity, the impact of the West on the daily lives of the Maronite rank and file was decisive. The establishment of the Maronite College in Rome in 1584 and the influence of its alumni within the ecclesiastical hierarchy transformed the church into a powerful political vehicle capable of mobilizing an increasingly assertive peasantry against the immobilism of the traditional feudal aristocracy. Furthermore, the influence of a growing petite bourgeoisie, enriched by trade and transformed in her self-perception by the impact of Western devotional practices introduced by the European missionaries in the 17th and 18th centuries, led the community to undertake the transformation of its political context with fateful consequences, as is widely known. The events of 1840 and 1860, the interconfessional fighting between Maronites and Druze in Mount Lebanon, while breaking havoc on the mountain and causing an incalculable amount of infrastructural and personal damage, would nonetheless lead the way to the establishment of the Mutasarrifiyye Jabal Lubnan, a semi-autonomous province under Ottoman sovereignty and the guarantee of the greater powers, where the church emerged as the undisputed hegemon. Under the Mutasarrifiyye, and notwithstanding the frequent disputes between the secular rulers representing Ottoman reformism and centralization, and the Patriarchate, conceiving of itself as the embodiment and spirit of the mountain, the Maronite community kept on growing and, more importantly, developing a proto-national sentiment that in the eve of World War I was already crystallizing around the demand for national independence and territorial enlargement. However, it was precisely the enlargement of Lebanon's borders operated with the establishment of the Greater Lebanese State in 1920, which prevented the Maronites from fulfilling their historical aspirations. The incorporation of the solid Muslim majorities inhabiting the annexed territories had turned the projected nation-state of the Maronites into a mosaic-like assembly of confessions and ethnic groups, an Islamo-Christian synthesis, a multi-communal melange where Christians were an exiguous majority and the Maronites represented but a minority among others. In this context, the successive Maronite patriarchs, adamantly opposed to any proposal for territorial reduction, were forced to adapt their discourse from the Christian exclusivism that had characterized it under the largely Christian Mutasarrifiyye to a pluralist expression reaching out to all Lebanese, regardless of their particular confessional ascription. In so doing, the patriarchs suffered the criticism of their fellow ecclesiastical hierarchs, many of whom remained attached to a traditional understanding of Lebanon, but also received the criticism of the Maronite rank and file, of the Maronite petit peuple, who by and large attached their identity to a Christian exclusivist idea of Lebanon linked to the sentimental geography of Mount Lebanon, which occupies the position of a hallowed land, a holy land in Maronite communal consciousness. One of the first displays of this new attitude can be found during the patriarchate of Monseigneur Antoine Arida, whose defense of the tobacco growers during the 1935 crisis generated by French attempts to impose a monopoly, to his rapprochement with the Syrian nationalists in Damascus under Lebanese allies, despite the misgivings of much of the church hierarchy. Subsequent breakdown of the alliance between Ibkirki and the Syrian shock cannot obscure the fundamental shift that this alliance had operated in the public perception of the Patriarchate. It had adopted a truly national pan-Lebanese role rather than being a mere loudspeaker for exclusivist Maronite interests. Further of this new attitude adopted by the patriarchal institution can be found on the role it came to play during the crisis that preceded national independence in 1943. Thus, the Patriarchate not only raised a national program constructed upon the principles of full national sovereignty, confessional and Wataniya nationalism, but also adopted a firm stance against the repressive measures undertaken by the French authorities in the aftermath of the constitutional amendments of November the 8th, when the mandate had been abrogated. As a consequence of this constitutional process, the Prime Minister, Riyad al-Sulh, and the President of the Lebanese Republic, Bashar al-Houri, together with most of the cabinet, had been detained by the French authorities, put under confinement in the Rashid citadel in the Lebanese periphery. This brought the church as a whole, including those prelates less committed to rabbinized independence, researched by both President Houthi and Prime Minister. Like, for instance, the outspoken Archbishop of Beirut, Monsignor Ignaz. Notwithstanding differences that some bishops had with the proposals of government, the church as a whole threw her weight behind the cabinet and against the arbitrariness of the French authorities in Lebanon. The rise of the Maronite as a national institution was reinforced during the patriarchate of Arida's successor, Monsignor Boulous Miaoui, directly appointed by the Holy See, which was wary of the isolationist stream dominating the Maronite Episcopal College for fear it may bring prejudice to her Middle Eastern policy. Let us remember for a brief moment that the church has always had a vested interest in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, very much in relation with the holy places in the occupied territories and in Israel. So the church, the Vatican elected Monsignor Miaoui to avoid the election of an isolationist Maronite patriarch that could in any way harm her diplomatic efforts in the Middle East. And in fact, Monsignor Miaoui opened the doors of the patriarchate to all Lebanese, regardless of their confession, and adopted a policy of proximity to Arab nationalism in the belief that it was, and I quote him, an effective means to maintain the loyalty of the Lebanese Muslims to the Republic, end quote. In fact, Monsignor Miaoui became the first Maronite patriarch to reach out actively to Lebanon's Muslim population. His patriarchate is, however, best remembered for the role he played in the events of 1958, when the conflict between President Shamoun and the mainly Muslim opposition threatened to unravel the foundations of the Lebanese political edifice. It is widely believed, though, that the patriarch's closeness to the opposition and his direct line with the Egyptian president, Jamal Abdel Nasser, while causing much discontent within his own community's episcopal hierarchy and laity, who went as far as to submit a complaint against him to the Holy See, prevented Lebanon actually from descending into the abyss of identitarian coercion and sectarian violence, where it was to plunge itself less than 20 years afterwards. The national turn undertaken by the church under Arida and Miaoui was not a linear process, however, and the rise of Palestinian Wataniya nationalism on Lebanese soil, with its corollary of violence, particularly after the collective Arab defeat of 1967, would lead the patriarchate to undertake a U-turn in its political stance, bringing the fundamental tenets of Maronitism. In the context of violent attacks, reprisals and counter-reprisals between Palestinians and Israelis, who alongside other regional powers were using Lebanon as the convenient arena to play their game of power politics, it is perhaps not surprising that the patriarchate and the church as a whole returned to the classical principles of this Maronite nationalism. Total sovereignty for Lebanon without any whatsoever and without loyalties extending beyond the country's national boundaries. The death of Monsignor Miaoui in January 1975, at a time when the political confessional tensions in the country were on the verge of exploding, put an end to an understanding of the patriarchate, which was in a certain imperial. His successor, Antoine Khoreish, possessing less abrasive a personality, would remain in the shadows throughout most of the civil war, always advocating for coexistence and conciliation, but lacking much political influence. In reality, the war caused the translation of communal leadership from the patriarch to the religious orders, which, under the leadership of the outspoken and bold Abbot Sharb el-Qassis and his successor, the no less caustic Abbot Paul Naaman, came to represent, much to the chagrin of the Holy See, the hardest Christian positions, going as far as to advocate for a quasi-partitionist stance. The leadership of Monsignor Sfai, Khreish's successor at the forefront of the patriarchate, while persevering on the moderate stances of his predecessor, would see a recovery of the patriarchate's prestige both nationally and within the Maronite community herself, despite his rocky beginnings when the patriarchal residence was assaulted by militants opposed to the prelate's acceptance of the Taif agreement. However, Sfaif's determined opposition to the Syrian occupation of Lebanon, where the Syrians remained until the so-called Sida Revolution of 2006, as is widely known, and his relentless attempts to bring about national reconciliation by sealing historical grievances, as happened during his well-known journey to Ashuf in 2000, restored much of the moral authority of the patriarchal throne and allowed Sfer to present himself as a national figure despite his somewhat outspoken remarks. His successor, Monsignor Bshara Arai, the present patriarch, has followed on the footsteps of his illustrious predecessor, taking a stance in favor of conviviality and rejecting the maximalist aspirations of the community's rank and file, thus positing the patriarchate once again as a neutral institution able to represent Lebanon as a whole rather than merely a single community. In this context, the proposals voiced by Monsignor Arai to host a UN-sponsored international conference in order to establish Lebanon's neutrality, thus consolidating the country on its, quote, modern constitutional foundation, end quote, as the patriarch announced on his homily of February the 7th, 2020, and his subsequent insistence on the matter should not be considered as a confessional claim, but rather as the expression of a national vow that beyond the mesh of disparate communities that compose the Lebanese polity, aspires to put Lebanon aside from the regional tensions that perpetually threatened its delicate internal balance. The widespread diffusion of the patriarch's message through the new technological means facilitated by the social networks, Facebook and Twitter especially, has allowed the prelate to reach the wider Lebanese public without the mediation of the traditional media outlets. In so doing, the head of the Maronite Church has been able to chastise openly the ineffectiveness, greed, and corruption of the political elites. He has also shown his concern for the crippling economic and financial crisis that has been paralyzing the country for well over 2 years, while also charging against the political hurdles that have been trying to put an end to the judicial inquest of the blast at Beirut's harbor last summer. In deploying such an active political activity in defense of points of view supported all across his country's demographic spectrum, the Maronite Patriarch has been able to remain the highest moral authority in Lebanon and its most qualified representative on the international regardless of the objective size of his constituency reduced by migration and lower fertility rate. However, in the midst of the present crisis, voices for federalism are started to be heard. Again, among qualified members of the Maronite public, I wonder whether the patriarchal institution is able to expand Lebanese appeal even at the risk of communal disaffection like happened during the civil war, or it will join Maronite voices calling for a revamping of the Lebanese edifice. Thank you very much.
We thank you all, Mr. Jorge Gonzalez. Let me say
thank you
briefly what you said in your presentation. Actually, we are not strange or we are familiar with the happenings, what's going on right now in Lebanon, in Beirut, from the news, as you know.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, that's right. Şunu arz etmeye çalıştı. Birkaç not aldım dinlerken de. Mesele şu, malum Maruniler, sayın katılımcılar, dinleyiciler, bu Lübnan'da büyük bir çoğunluğa sahip olan bir topluluk ve Cumhurbaşkanı'nın da Maruni olması zorunluluğu var. Ve şunu anlatmaya çalışıyor tebliğcimiz, efendim, özellikle bu Lübnan'ın yapılanmasında, sosyal problemlerin giderilmesinde ve bir kaynaşmanın oluşmasında Maroni Patrikliğinin böyle dar bir kapsamdan ulusal bir seviyeye ulaşmasının ehemmiyetine, önemine vurgu yapıyor. Belki bu bir dar topluluk olarak efendim oldu ama aslında diyor Lübnan'ın huzuru için, sosyal barışın, ekonomik efendim krizlere çözüm bulabilmesi için bu dar bakış açısından ulusal bir level'a, seviyeye geçmenin ve uzlaşmanın da zorunluluğuna bir vurgu yaptı. Mr. Boja, right now who is the Patrick? Bikara Arai?
Bishara Arai, yes.
Right now, da. Okay. Actual patriarch, that's right?
Yes, the present patriarch, indeed.
Okay, present. Then he wants to get good connection with the state, that's right? In the national basis.
Yes, I mean, he has been trying to construct a pan-Lebanese constituency. When he speaks, he does not refer exclusively to his own community. He speaks to Lebanon as a whole, to Lebanon understood as a nation.
Okay, thank you very much. Şu andaki aktif olan Patrick Bishara Errai, yani hakikaten bu dar kapsamdan kurtulup bütün Beyrut halkına ifade etmeye çalışan, ona hitap etmeye çalışan ve Beyrut halkın bir bütün olarak bir araya getirme mücadelesi veren bir konum. Bunun üzerinde durdu ağırlıklı olarak. Şöyle bakıyorum, birkaç not almıştım. Yani bu kargaşanın Lübnan'da giderilmesi adına bir genel çağrı da olarak ortaya çıkıyor. Ve bu Patrikhane'nin tarih boyunca Lübnan'daki fonksiyonu tekrar gözden geçirmesi ve bu heterojen bir nüfus içerisinde Lübnan'ın birliği, dirliği için bir kilit görevi, bir görevi üstlendiğini de bu rolü korumasına da bir vurgu yapıyor efendim. Thank you very much, Mr. Actually, we are supposed to listen to another speaker, but he didn't show up yet. But if you don't mind, he has sent his abstract before. Maybe I don't know, he has a problem, something, that's why he cannot appear on the show. With your permission, in a couple of minutes, just I give a brief abstract of his presentation paper. Ali Rıza Ahmedi, he's supposed to get in the program from Tehran International University, historical ideology master, yüksek lisansını yapan bir şahıstı. Şunu diyor, ben Türkçe olarak, with your permission, in Turkish, I give the listener a brief summary. Başlık şu: the spread of Manichaeism religion from Iran to the Middle East and beyond in the 3rd century AD. 3. yüzyılda İran'dan Orta Doğu ve ötesine Manichaeizmin yaymasını ele alıyordu. Burada da bu Manichaeizminin işte Hristiyanlıktan, Zerdüştlükten, Budizm ve Ignostik dinlerden bir müteşekkil bir inanç olduğunu, işte bu ve bir takım bunlardan kaynaklandığını ifade, mesela Kurtarıcı İsa fikrini Hristiyanlıktan aldığını, bu dualite ikilemi işte Zerdüştlükten aldığını ve bu noktada özellikle zaman içerisinde Manichaeizmin bu bölgede yayıldığını ve hatta Orta Doğu, Avrupa, Kuzey Afrika, Hindistan, Çin, Orta Asya'ya kadar burada bir evrensel güç olduğuna bir vurgu yapıyor. Akabinden özellikle yavaş yavaş bu Manichaeizmin bölgedeki tesirinin azaldığını ve zaman içerisinde de hatta mesela özellikle bu Katolik kilisenin Manichaeizmi ateizm olarak ilan ettiğini ve buna rağmen Manichaeistlerin bu sosyal dayanışmaları sürdürdüklerini ve mani inancına sahip olanların bu sosyal dayanışmayı ve inanca bağlılığı sürdürdüklerine, ısrarcı olduklarına vurgu yapıyor. En nihayetinde İslam'ın gelişiyle beraber de yavaş yavaş İslam'ın gölgesi altında kaldığını, ama son cümlesi şu idi özetinde, diyor ki hala mani dini İslam'ın bölgede yayılmasıyla birlikte ciddi bir rakip haline gelmiştir demektedir. Okay, dear speakers, we have 10 minutes. Then, if you don't mind, please could you turn on your video and microphone? I would like to give a couple of minutes for each. Yes, Mr. Davis, if you want to something add, please go ahead. A couple of minutes, please.
Just to add any information.
Okay, good.
Well, thank you obviously very much for having me. I don't have a huge amount more to say. I guess the only points that I wanted to raise that to relate them to the theme of the conference in general is this idea about sectarianism being the I guess one of the key aspects of the history of modernity in the Arab states of the Middle East. And my my research at the moment is focused on I guess trying to get beyond these frameworks to point out I guess the weakness of our kind of like analytical language pertaining to sectarianism. And specifically I've been influenced by the work of recent work of Fanar Haddad, who's written quite a lot on sectarianism in Iraq specifically, and he's trying to really deconstruct what we mean by it. I don't know. I mean, I'm happy to answer any questions if anyone's got any.
Okay, do you mean that Al-Sharqi, with your permission, Al-Sharqi, yep, although he's a Shi'i, right, mm-hmm, but he wants to give importance to Arab lineage?
Yes. Right? Yeah. Yeah.
Of and by that, what is his aim?
So I think he's a nationalist. He wants to create an inclusive and integrated nation state in Iraq. I think his political movement stems from a regional sense of identity, which is actually associated with him being from the Euphrates and from the plains of the Euphrates, especially the mid Euphrates and the lower Euphrates. What I'm trying to say is that this regional sense of identity was perhaps even stronger than the confessional ties, the Shia confessional ties that he had with the other inhabitants of that region.
Then in this sense, is there a problem with Al-Sharqi and Al-Nahda between?
How do you mean a problem?
Is there a problem or conflict?
So he was part of
Al-Sharqi and Nahda. Is it Nahda?
No. I think they're one and the same. Al-Sharqi kind of represents the views of Al-Nahda.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ben okay, anlamaya çalışayım. Yani Şarkı Şii ama aslında bir milliyetçi, bir ulusal bir devlet yapılanmayı daha çok önemsiyor, değil mi efendim? Irak'ta böyle bir yapı için bir arada mücadele ediyor. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nur Hanım, please go ahead if you have something to say in a couple of minutes.
Actually, I don't have to add anything, but I would be happy to answer questions. I think there is a question in chat box for me.
Okay, but I couldn't see the question. Did you see it?
From Hatice Terlemez.
Okay, please go ahead.
She wonders how these artifacts come to these museums. But should I give answer English or Turkish? I couldn't be sure.
It doesn't matter. In Turkish, you can do that. No problem.
Okay. Okay, I'm continue Turkish then.
Okay, what's the question? Soru neydi?
O eserlerin o müzelere nasıl gittiklerini merak ediyorum demiş kendisi.
Ha. Okay, it's better say in English, maybe the other non speakers
sure.
Maybe. Okay.
Sure, no problem. There are several ways how these materials come to the UK and the other European museums, of course. For example, I can say one and maybe the more important one is political instability at that time, especially in 19th century Ottoman time and just before the starting the Republic. And that time, lots of Western archaeologues and collectioners came to the Eastern countries, not only Turkey, to Iran, Iraq, Syria, and many other countries, especially Egypt, and make some excavations in these countries and find some materials and bring them to the UK. And also in this political instability, there was some people from Turkey, from Ottoman lands, was selling these objects to these collectors because they was trying to get some beneficial things from these political issues. So another thing, Iznik ceramics, especially I can say about Iznik ceramics, was very popular, not as I mentioned in my presentation, not only in the Ottoman lands, it was very popular in Europe as well. So especially rich people were ordering Iznik ceramics for themselves, and they were coming from Ottoman lands to the UK. They were paying money for them. And then when they pass out, they just leave these objects to the museums because they were probably collectioners and they had many special objects like Iznik ceramics, and they just leave it to the museums. And yes, there are some ways, legal and illegal.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, let me say in Turkish a little bit maybe. As I understood, şunu dedi hoca hanım, arkadaşlar, bu soru şuydu herhalde. Bu ürünler nasıl İngiltere'ye ulaştı diye. Evet. Şunu ifade etti hoca hanım. Tabii Osmanlı son dönemindeki bu siyasi kargaşadan kaynaklanan durum var. İşte batılı arkeologların diye mi gelip kazı yapmaları, takım işte koleksiyoncuların ülkemize gelip Osmanlı coğrafyasında bunları ele geçirmeleri, efendim legal ve illegal yollarla. Yine bu arada efendim Osmanlı'nın vatandaşlarından belki bunlar satanlar da oldu. Bunu ifade etti hoca hanım. Bir de zengin insanların biraz da İznik çini ve seramiklerine karşı ilgileri var. Ve bunları tabii evlerinde, mekanlarında kullanmak, görmek istiyorlar. Bunları satın aldıkları ve bir kısmını anladığım kadar müzelere efendim bırakarak bunların teşhir edilip gösterilmelerine imkan ve zemin hazırlamış oldular dediler. Değil mi?
Özellikle Kanuni Sultan Süleyman döneminde sadece İznik, yani bu tarz materyaller değil, moda olarak da çok aslında örnek alınan, taklit edilen bir kıyafet tekstil modası var. Tamam. Osmanlı topraklarında.
İngilizce söylüyorsa arkadaş anlarlar, pardon, diğer şeyler de anlasınlar. Oldu mu?
Okay.
The last part.
Yeah, in the magnificent Süleyman, Kanuni Sultan Süleyman, in the time, there is a fashion, Ottoman fashion in Europe. They are following the Ottoman fashion in their clothes, and they are trying to copying it. When you go to museums in the UK, you can see the if Christopher maybe visited the National Museum Scotland, there is a Scottish fashion part in there, and there are clothes made and designed in the Scotland, but they are copying and following the Ottoman style. So it is very popular. They are just ordering clothes and textile materials as well as Iznik ceramics.
Okay, bu modadan kaybedin bir moda ve onu örnek alınması, değil mi? Kastettiğiniz o örnek alınarak bir moda oluşumunda, evet, da bu Osmanlı ürünleri, İznik seramikleri, hatta elbiseler bile efendim rol oynamışlar. Efendim, we have just one or two minutes. Mr. Borja.
Yes, I don't have
it. In a couple of minutes.
Yes, very rapidly, just an advertisement rather than an addition. What the content of my presentation is to a large extent a part of my book, A Political History of the Maronite Community, which was published by Necmettin Erbakan University Press this last spring. So if you want to know more about the political history of the Maronites in Lebanon, I invite you all to buy it or to ask your local library to get it. Thank you very much.
Okay, by the way, there is a question for you, if you don't mind. Let me ask the question. Someone asked, if Al-Sharqi is an Arab nationalist, how he constrain his nationalism with only Iraq? What is his opinions about the other areas?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it's in this period in the 1920s, the difference between Arab nationalism and territorial nationalisms is quite ambiguous, and you know, different thinkers would appeal to both at the same time. and it wouldn't, there wasn't that clear distinction that you get later on, especially after the 1940s in Iraqi discourse. I think it's what's been interesting about his particular conception of the Euphrates is that it's basically a way to combine the two, because to be in his discourse, to be an Arab from the Euphrates is to be the most sort of authentic Arab population, and therefore Iraq is kind of the most authentic Arab nation. So it's actually a way to rewrite the history of Arab nationalism away from places like Syria and Beirut and stuff, and say that it's actually all about the populations of southern Iraq, and challenge the idea that there's a kind of a big Persian influence there, which is obviously what many perhaps like anti Shia voices would have expressed from places like Baghdad.
Okay, thank you so much. This was very good session, and I'm sure that it will contribute very much to our understanding in Middle East, what's going on, what happened in the past, and what will happen in the future. Thank you very much for everybody, for speakers and for the listeners also. And I have to close the session with your permission.
Thank you very much.
In the next program, inshallah. Take care.
Inshallah.
Thank you.
Take care. Okay. Thank you all.
Bye.